Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 14th meeting of 2024 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. And we have apologies this morning from our convener, Karen Adam, and from Annie Wells. Our first agenda item this morning is an evidence session on the Disability Commissioner Scotland Bill, and I refer members to Papers 1 and 2. And this morning, I am very pleased to welcome to our meeting Dr. Arun Chopra, Executive Medical Director, Mental Welfare Commission for Scotland, Stephanie Griffin, Scotland Policy Manager from the Equality and Human Rights Commission, Nick Hobbs, Head of Advice and Investigations from Children and Young People's Commissioner, Scotland, and Jan Savage, Executive Director of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. You are all very welcome, and thank you for your time and attendance this morning. I will invite each of you to provide a brief opening statement, should you wish to do so, before we move to members' questions. So, Dr. Chopra, can I invite you to start?
Morning, and thank you for the invitation to speak to the committee today and give evidence. I thought I'd start by talking a little bit about the Mental Welfare Commission, so you've got a sense of the perspective that we're taking on the discussion today about the Disability Commissioner. The Mental Welfare Commission is a safeguard for the rights of people with mental illness and learning disability. We achieve that safeguard through visiting people in settings where they might be detained. We see about 1,200 people per year. We run a phone advice line, which is open to professionals and people with lived experience and carers. We take about 3,500 phone calls a year, mostly on that complex area between ethics, law, and clinical practice. We also authorise medication for people who cannot give consent due to mental illness or learning disability as per the Act. We organise about 2,700 visits by our designated medical practitioners per year. And we publish around two or three investigations when things have not gone well for people with mental illness or learning disability, with the aim of sharing that learning across services in Scotland. So that's a bit about the background to the Commission and what we do. And as you'll have heard, one of our key focus areas is around people with learning disability. And that brings us on to talking about the Disability Commissioner. We very much welcome the outcomes which the bill sets out to achieve for people with disabilities. However, we think that there may be more effective and efficient ways to achieve those outcomes rather than necessarily establishing a Disability Commissioner, which may lead to issues around duplication of process and function, some of the ones which I've already mentioned. We think there's an opportunity for clarity around safeguards and a real focus for some of the constituencies that we work with, people with learning disability, and safeguarding their rights. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Chopra. If I can move to Stephanie Griffiths now. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you for the opportunity to come along to committee today as well. The Equality and Human Rights Commission is Britain's equality and human rights regulator. We're also an accredited national human rights institution, although our human rights responsibilities here in Scotland only extend to reserved matters. The Equality Act 2006 is our founding legislation. It sets out our general duty, as well as our general powers and also enforcement powers. We might come on to talk about some of those later in respect to this bill, as I think there is potential sort of significant overlap in some of these areas with some of the powers and duties of the Disability Commissioner that are in the bill. The Equality Act 2010 came into force in October 2010, and that provides a single legal framework to tackle discrimination and harassment, and it contains provisions to protect disabled people from unlawful treatment and promote a fairer and more equal society. Together, those two acts sort of set out a robust legal framework, and we are the regulator of that, and we address discrimination, promote equality of opportunity for all 9 protected characteristics set out in the legislation, including disability. It's also worth noting, I think specifically at this point, that our regulatory approach also recognises that regulation doesn't just mean legal enforcement action, such as inquiries and investigations. It also means providing advice, raising awareness and understanding, transferring expertise and supporting organisations in their efforts to comply with the law. And we also keep emerging law and policies under review. I hope that's a helpful sort of quick overview of our sort of unique role and mandate, and I'm happy to take any questions on that.
Thank you very much, Stephanie. Move to Nick Hobbs, please.
Good morning, and thank you as well for the invitation to come and speak to you today. The role of the Children and Young People's Commission of Scotland is to promote and safeguard children's rights. We're recognised as an independent children's rights institution, And it's worth noting that one of the groups of children who were accorded special protection under the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child are disabled children and young people. There's no doubt that disabled children experience significant rights violations and that much more needs to be done to ensure that their rights are fulfilled and that public services meet their needs. We only have to look at some of the issues that our office has worked on over the last couple of years to see that: restraints and seclusion, additional support needs, fuel poverty, deprivation of liberty. And so we're very mindful of the issues and the strength of feeling that they rightly generate. But it's also important to understand, I think, that much of the dissatisfaction that seems to have driven the proposal to create a new commissioner comes from an implementation gap. So the proposal seems to be a reaction to ineffective legal and policy implementation and the existence of significant barriers to justice, and we have to consider the proposal and the extent to which it will be able to address those issues. Our office is frequently cited as the model that new commissioner proposals want to reflect, and it's obviously enormously heartening for us that people see the value of the commissioner's office and want to emulate it. And the commissioner model can be very effective, but as the Finance Committee is currently examining, we need to consider proposals for new office holders in relation to the existing landscape. Otherwise, there's a risk of creating a fragmented, confusing and ineffective system which could inadvertently create more barriers to justice. And in particular, we know that children's voices and interests are often lost in organisations that aren't specifically designed and run for them. There's a risk, I think, of setting up a new office to fail if it's not properly resourced, and we have real concerns that this one isn't. And that's without considering the impact on the resources available to existing office holders to carry out the work that they've been charged with doing by the Scottish Parliament. And I look forward to discussing all of that in more detail.
Okay. Thank you very much, Nick. And Jan Savage, over to you.
Thank you, Deputy Convener and Committee, for the opportunity to provide evidence this morning to inform your consideration of the Disability Commissioner Bill. As the Committee is aware, the Scottish Human Rights Commission is established via the Scottish Commission for Human Rights Act 2006, with a general duty to promote the human rights of everyone in Scotland, and that of course includes the human rights of disabled people in Scotland. As such, the first thing that we would want to say is that we agree with the policy intent of the proposal. Absolutely more needs to be done to strengthen accountability around the human rights of disabled people. The intent of the legislation is therefore the right one, which is to strengthen those rights. We would also like to recognise the contribution of Jeremy Balfour, MSP, as being such a significant and effective champion for those rights. This bill is the culmination of many years of work in this Parliament and beyond to do so, and we pay tribute to that. We do, however, encourage the committee to consider whether the bill as proposed is the best or only model available to deliver on that policy intent. We are concerned that the proposed Disability Commissioner, as has been outlined in the bill, may be under-resourced to deliver the policy intent as explored, and that its existence could actually create further complexities in what's already a complex, messy and inaccessible access to justice system for rights holders. We think that there are potential alternative and or complementary models that should be explored, all of which would result in the rights of disabled people in Scotland being better protected. The timing of this stage one consideration aligns with two other key developments in the human rights legal framework in Scotland, which we just briefly want to touch on. The Scottish Human Rights Bill, which we understand the Scottish Government is intending to lay before the Scottish Parliament in this session, intends to incorporate the UN Convention on the Rights of Disabled People into Scots law. And we think it would be really important for the committee to establish the extent to which that incorporation would be proposed in order to understand the impact that that may have on accountability for the rights of disabled people. The Public Finance and Administration Committee is already the final stages, or the latter stages of its inquiry into a strategic landscape around commissioners. And it's looking at many of the considerations that the Commission itself proposed last summer around the reasons why behind the proposals for new commissions. We understand that we're here for a reason, that this bill has been proposed for a reason, and that reason is that accountability gap and the implementation gap between policy and experience and the levers which exist in the system to improve experiences. We think that the starting point here is the need to ensure that mechanisms and institutions which already exist have the necessary powers and resources to better protect the rights of disabled people. In our view, the Scottish Human Rights Commission, as Scotland's national human rights institution, has deficiencies in its current mandate, and we've explored that before with the committee. There has never been a review of that mandate in the 16 years since the Commission has been in existence. And we think that as a first step, which would benefit all rights holders in Scotland, including disabled people, a review of that mandate is overdue. We think that there are specifically more definite and definitive things that the Commission could be expended, could develop to enhance the rights of disabled people in particular, and we can explore that further during the evidence session. We already note that there are so many effective disability champions in Scotland. Mr Balfour is one. Civil society is full of exceptional disability champions who are doing a wonderful job in raising awareness, and we question whether that we need more of that, or whether we need to focus more of our attention on the actions that need to be taken to improve the accountability mechanisms in respect of those rights. So finally, we call on the committee to take into account that wider context, and we offer our evidence in that basis, and to make sure that the guiding principle for this morning's consideration, and indeed the entirety of the Stage 1 process, is that whatever happens, we don't make accountability for disabled people's rights in Scotland more complex and the access to justice system more difficult, and whatever happens, that we take this opportunity to enhance those rights through the debates that we'll have through the Stage 1 process.
Thank you very much, Jan. Thank you all for that. We'll move to questions now, and I'll kick off. You've all in different ways said that you support the principles and sort of the outcomes, the desired outcomes of the proposed Disability Commissioner and the legislation that we're considering. And the consultation, the members' consultation that was held, shows strong support for a commissioner role. I suppose, could you maybe say just a little bit about why you think that is? We've heard talk of implementation gaps, of accountability gaps. What's failing? What's going wrong? And Nick, can I start with you? And I suppose in your responses, you know, what is going wrong, and what is it that your organisation specifically are seeking to do in this space? So Nick, if I can start with you.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I referred in my opening statement to, and you mentioned it again, Deputy Convener, to an implementation gap. And so we see that across the board in relation to children and young people in a whole range of different issues. But I think it's particularly acute for disabled children and young people. And so you can look, for instance, at additional support needs in education as a really good example of where legislation, by and large, is pretty good. But there's a real issue around implementation and around realisation of rights within that system. So we've done a lot of work in the past on that area. We came to Parliament a few weeks ago to present our strategic plan for the next 4 years, and that includes a really significant piece of work around education rights, and the rights of children with disabilities will be absolutely key to that in terms of how children's rights to education are being realised within the system. So that I think is a really good example of where we're falling short in relation to implementation issues, and that requires not just a focus on what the legal framework and the legal mechanisms are, but what are the barriers to actually getting that policy realised and implemented, and a great deal of it, I think, unavoidably, is about resource at the moment. It's about resource, and it's about training, and it's about understanding of rights. And Jan Savage was quite right to note the very significant changes that are coming, which we hope will have an impact on that. So first of all, the UNCRC Act is going to be implemented from July the 16th this year. And so that provides an additional route, not only for challenge of legislation, but also for children and young people to take action to realise their rights, and for our office to have additional powers in that regard, which is really important. But also the ongoing conversation, and hopefully very shortly we'll see a human rights bill introduced to the Parliament, which incorporates the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, which will again provide that much stronger framework for accountability and for action where rights realisation is falling short of what we would all want it to be.
Thanks very much, Nick. Jan, if I can come to you, similar question, you know, where are the issues with accountability, with implementation, and where do you see SHRC's role as working in this space?
So I think, Deputy Convener, exactly as Nick has outlined, so we know and we agree that with what disabled people tell us and experience every single day almost, that the intent of policy is just far too often not being met in rights realisation in day-to-day lives. At the moment, as organisations, we have a role to monitor that, and we do, and we monitor implementation of Scotland's performance against the UNCRPD, and we take that evidence directly from disabled people's lives, working with DPOs, working with civil society, and we report that to the United Nations, and we provide independent, without fear or favour, assessment of how disabled people's rights are being realised in Scotland. I think the issue that we experience and the frustration that we have as an institution, which is felt then by disabled people, is so what?
What next?
And what next? And yes, we can monitor. And as far as I can see, what's been proposed through the proposed Disability Commissioner is an enhanced monitoring role and an investigatory function for a new commissioner. But it still wouldn't address that accountability gap, the what next. And that's part of the Commission's objectives in this Parliament, is to work through the Scottish Parliament to establish where there are deficiencies in the mandate of the Commission to be able to take action to, for example, raise own name legal proceedings, to take test cases through the courts where we have evidence of human rights violations impacting on one person that have a greater systemic impact. That would be something that would really go some way to closing that accountability gap, testing the rule of law through the Scottish court system and providing advice and guidance, therefore, to duty bearers as to how to implement that legislation and to have the law on the right side of the rights holders. At the moment, that's just not a lever that we have open to us as a national human rights institution. That is a lever that is open to other national human rights institutions, including HRC in different parts of Great Britain. And that's a deficiency in the mandate that we believe the Commission and should work with Parliament to close. We would say that that should happen in addition to, or if it's the will of Parliament to progress with a Disability Commissioner, we would still require that amendment to the Scottish Human Rights Commission's founding mandate and legislation to enable that lever to exist. It would exist then for disabled people, but it would exist then for all people. And that's a really important principle when it comes, obviously, to the protection of human rights.
Okay, thanks. I know some of my colleagues will pick up on potential overlaps and duplications. But is SHRC concerned If we do go down the road, as you say, of agreeing the Disability Commissioner, are you concerned about the potential that certain commissioners will have powers that the National Rights Institution does not have? Is that something that causes SHRC concern as well?
There's definitely a concern with that. So I think the first thing to say is we do, as we already have in place, mechanisms to work in partnership with other organisations. So if there were to be a new Disability Commissioner set up, we would seek to arrange memorandum of understanding and we would make it work. However, we do have a clause in our legislation which makes it clear that we must not duplicate the work of other organisations. So the first potential unintended consequence that could arise from this proposed Commissioner would be that the Commission would not be able to do as much of the monitoring work it does currently in respect of disabled people's rights. That would be a concern. The second concern would be, as you've outlined, Deputy Convener, actually, as proposed, the Disability Commissioner would have a power of investigation, which the Scottish Human Rights Commission does not have for all people living in Scotland. And so there's a definite disparity there. And that then starts to create a hierarchy, if not of rights, but a hierarchy of routes to access justice for particular groups of rights, which would be a concern.
Okay, thanks, Jan. Stephanie, if I can come to you, similar kind of question. I know you said in your opening remarks the extent of EHRC's powers, but where do you see some of the problems around implementation and accountability that we've heard? Where do you see that on as? And has EHRC had any thought to actually look at this particular area in any detail?
Yeah, if I can just start, Deputy Convener, if that's all right. But I don't think I was particularly clear in our opening statement, but just to put on record that we are sort of fully supportive of any proposals to ensure disabled people's voices are heard across society, including in relation to the development of legislation and policy. I think the policy objectives set out in the policy memorandum include objectives that we are fully supportive of, including promoting awareness and understanding of the rights of disabled people. In terms of the sort of first question you asked, if I can just reflect on that as well, I think we can understand the appetite to do something in this area to ensure the inequalities faced by disabled people are drawing focus and being acted upon. As we mentioned in our written response to the committee's call for views on the bill, our recent State of the Nation report on equalities and human rights sort of outlined and highlighted that while experiences for disabled people have improved in some areas, there remain sort of stark inequalities in many areas of disabled people's lives in Scotland, and some of those inequalities are also referenced in the Bill's memorandum. And I think in that context, it's sort of clear that greater commitment and action is needed to tackle inequalities faced by disabled people in Scotland. And reflecting on what others have said, I think that is, you know, it comes down to implementation gap and unfortunately resource as well. I think from an EHRC specific perspective, we consider that the sort of current requirements of the Equality Legal Framework are a key lever in tackling inequalities, and the requirement of the Equality Act and the Scottish specific duties in relation to mainstreaming should mean that listed bodies are considering equality in their work already. We know that Scottish Government are clear that that should be happening too, and there's plans to sort of refresh their own mainstreaming strategy. I think we know as a regulator that listed bodies' compliance with some aspects of the Scottish specific duties and the public sector equality duty can be, the compliance can be patchy. And alongside our sort of regular regulatory work to improve compliance, we've also worked closely with Scottish Government on the review of public sector equality duty here in Scotland to sort of consider and act upon recommendations that would mean that the Scottish specific duties, public sector equality duty here in Scotland is more effective. We consider that a better focus would be on improving Scottish specific duties and making sure that that framework works. I think as well as our role, that's a very HRC sort of focused answer, but I think as well as our role with the unique sort of legal powers that we utilise, and some examples of that, you know, our recent announcement in terms of the DWP investigation, whereby we're examining, we're investigating under the powers that we have, serious concerns that have been raised, including cases involving death of claimants. That's an example of using our powers, I think, to sort of further the rights of disabled people and investigate where some of the systems and processes we have in place are going wrong. I think the other thing I would want to touch on is that as well as our role with those unique legal powers that we utilise, it's sort of important to consider the existing work done by, you know, others on the panel here, as well as that sort of vibrant civil society, including the sort of wide range of national, regional and local disabled people's organisations representing people, disabled people generally, and people with specific conditions as well. So sort of coming back to what Jan said there, I think that, you know, the implementation gap is an issue. I think resourcing is an issue, and I think it might be a better course of action rather than set up a new body and sort of directing resources to a new body. Some of the issues around resourcing of existing bodies might be considered as well. In summary, I think we agree that there's not enough happening to tackle inequalities faced by disabled people. I'm not sure that we're convinced the answer to that is another commissioner.
Okay, thanks very much, Stephanie. And finally, Aaron, if I can come back to you. In your opening comments, you set out what Mental Welfare Commission does, and I think it's helpful to see it in that context, where you obviously have very clear evidence of where there is that accountability, where there are those accountability and implementation gaps, and yet you say quite clearly as well that maybe this isn't the right route to remedy. What is it in the work that the Mental Welfare Commission does? Where do you see the challenges around those gaps of implementation and accountability?
Yeah, no, thank you. I think when we think about that implementation gap, I think there are some issues around resource, there are some issues around culture, and there are some issues around policy and legislative drivers. I think if I could illustrate that with two examples, I think that would probably be the most helpful way for the committee to think about that. So through the work of the Commission, through that phone line, and through our visiting, when we see people in settings where they might be detained or they may even be informal, we see a delay for people with disabilities in getting home. So they will spend longer in hospital than someone who doesn't have a disability. Mm-hmm. We know of that gap. The coming home report is about that gap. It's how do we implement and how do we close that gap? So there's some great initiatives that have already started, but there needs to be a much more targeted focus on closing that gap that's there from the implementation of the coming home report. Another area, and I think Nick touched on that in his opening statement, was around restraint and seclusion. So this is an area where there isn't enough, I think, of a policy and legislative driver. So one of the other things that we do is we monitor the use of the Mental Health Act and the Adults with Incapacity Act, which are two big pieces of legislation which have a profound impact on people with disabilities. And currently, there is no legislative requirement that the Mental Welfare Commission monitors how many people are restrained, how many people are subject to seclusion. And yet we know from our visiting work and we know from our phone line conversations that we have with people that actually people with disabilities are much more likely to be subjected to restraint or be subjected to seclusion. So wouldn't it be helpful if there was a requirement that restraint and seclusion are also monitored? So that's a policy thing. It might need legislation to make that into one of the safeguarded interventions that gets monitored. That would probably lead to a greater fulfilment of rights of people with a disability than having a champion who will make these points clearly. But we already know about these points. We already know that there are existing gaps. So they're the sort of things that they're two examples, that there are others, but they're the sort of things that I think would make a difference for people in terms of closing that implementation and accountability gap.
Thanks, that's very helpful. And you touched on safeguards there as well, and in your opening remarks you talked about the need for greater clarity around safeguards. Can you just say a little bit more about that? Because I think the safeguards will mean slightly different things in different contexts. What is it that you're talking about when you're talking about safeguards for disabled people and your work?
Yeah, and I fully accept that. So when I talk about safeguards, I'm talking about it within the context of the Mental Health Act 2003 in Scotland and the Adults with Incapacity Act. My organisation is charged with delivering some of those safeguards. So if someone is detained and it's been beyond 2 months and they're still having medication without their consent, a safeguard is that we will have a designated medical practitioner who will go out and check that that treatment is appropriate and that is legally authorised. So that's an example of a safeguard. Okay. Another example of a safeguard would be if someone is being detained in an emergency setting, it's not just a doctor who makes that decision, it's also a social worker, a mental health officer. So our acts and our legislation has inbuilt safeguards. Mm-hmm. And I suppose where I'm coming from in this conversation is that I think we could enhance safeguards, particularly for people with disabilities. The way that the Mental Health Act is framed, we already have to specify whether someone has a mental illness, a learning disability, or a personality disorder. It wouldn't be a huge leap to say, if we know someone has a disability, a learning disability specifically, what additional safeguards can we put in place so that they get home earlier, they don't get restrained as much, that there's an additional set of eyes, monitoring with purpose that actually prevents them from experiencing some of the gaps that we've spoken about already this morning.
Thanks very much. That's really helpful. I'll move on to Megan, if you want to.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I've listened with interest so far in terms of what you've had to say about the potential introduction of a disability commissioner. The Glasgow Disability Alliance, one of the largest disability organisations in Europe with over 5,000 members, put in a submission to this bill, and they're quoted as saying, despite knowing about the work, especially of the Scottish Human Rights Commission and the Equality and Human Rights Commission, the consensus is that now, more than ever, Scotland needs a disability commissioner whose sole focus is on disabled people. So we know that organisations have had powers. We've spoken about potential extensions of powers this morning to make a difference. But I think it is quite clear that disabled people still feel disadvantaged just now. They still feel as though that they're back of the line when it comes to being able to know about their rights and exercising their rights. So I'm wondering, how will this change if we don't have a disability commissioner? And Jan, if I could start with yourself, please.
No, I'm absolutely happy to. So I think, that, again, the first thing to say is goes back to the statement I made at the start. I hear everything that the Glasgow Disability Alliance are saying, and they're quite right. I think everyone's right to be outraged about the status of rights realisation for disabled people in Scotland, full stop. I think the question that we're asking ourselves here is, what's the purpose then of a disability commissioner in that space? And as it appears to me, I think it seeks to do sort of three things. One is to have a visible champion, someone who is, bar nothing else, there to stand up for and promote the rights of disabled people. And I think it's often important that that's someone from the disability community, a disabled person themselves, I think is really important for visibility's sake. So that's a champion. There's also the monitoring element, so to keep an eye and to keep watch on what's happening in respect of disabled people's rights. And there are organisations currently, including the organisations you've just referenced, and the SHRC to an extent, that has that responsibility. The third element is the so what is the accountability. And at the moment, as far as I can see, what's been proposed even through Mr Balfour's bill doesn't really add any new levers of accountability into the system beyond those which already exist within the context of the Children's Commissioner's mandate around investigations, or the sorts of research and monitoring that the SHRC could currently undertake. So I think what's helpful to do is to sort of take it through those steps and consider if it's champion, then there's the potential route there for Mr Balfour's proposal to have merit. There are alternative routes to consider, which could be for the Scottish Human Rights Commission, for example, to be empowered to have more members of the Commission appointed by Parliament, one of whom could be given the specific remit of being a champion for disabled people's rights. Our legislation prevents that from happening currently. That would require an amendment to our legislation, but that could be done. Another alternative would be to amend our legislation to create a stronger monitoring team, a more permanent monitoring focus, a rapporteurship type model, as we've talked about before, that has that permanent specific function of monitoring the rights of disabled people in Scotland. Currently, we have a staff team of 14 people monitoring the rights of the enjoyment of the human rights of everyone in Scotland across all of the treaties. And so we have to then focus our time as appropriately through the UN treaty monitoring cycle. So we do that, but we could have a permanent function there, and that could be another route to achieve that. The final gap would be in that accountability and actually the levers to achieve change. And as I've explored already, these are not levers which any of us have appropriately as the current commissions. And that if that was to be achieved, I think that would be something that should appropriately be delivered through the Scottish Human Rights Commission, so that that lever is in place for all people and all rights. So I think there are alternative routes to look at. And of course, there are other conversations to be had with other places. So we're talking here about a parliamentary commissioner. If there is a need for a champion or a czar-type model, that could be a conversation to pick up separately with Scottish Government. So I think there are alternative routes. But what it all comes back down to is the issue is absolutely the issue, and there is no doubt that that's valid. It's considering what's the purpose and intent of the proposal, and what's genuinely going to be the best route to achieve that.
Okay.
Thank you. I agree with everything that Jan's just said, and I think it's useful to try to think about What is it we're trying to achieve through this, and to separate it out into those kind of different strands. And I think restraint perhaps provides a good example of where some of the challenges will come around this. So if we're talking about a champion role, and I think there is something about what people see when they look at some of our offices. They see the profile, they see commissioners talking in the media, they see them appearing in Parliament. And I think sometimes there's maybe a bit of an overestimation about what that can achieve without a whole load of work behind the scenes and actual enforcement and powers and teeth. So if you think about restraint, that's something that was the first investigation carried out by our office, and we made really strong recommendations, but were unable to get the Scottish Government to take any action on them until we worked with the Equality and Human Rights Commission to bring legal proceedings against the Scottish Government, and that then resulted in a commitment to produce guidance. We then, at the end of last year, the four organisations represented here, plus the Promise Scotland, wrote to Scottish Government calling for a commitment to create a coherent legal framework around restraint and seclusion across all settings where children are in the care of the state. And that was in large part because we recognised, as Aaron touched on, the extent to which restraint and seclusion disproportionately impact upon disabled children and young people. It would be nice, I think, to think that one additional voice would be the thing that tips the balance and gets Scottish Government to act on that. But if I'm being very honest, I think that's very unlikely. What will move that issue, what will shift the dial, is once the UNCRC Act is in force, whether there are opportunities for either our office or for children and young people to directly access their rights through the Scottish courts. Unfortunately, I think that's the thing that's going to be required. So exactly as Jan's saying, it's about what is the power and what is the route that's going to actually shift these issues, where we know what the issue is. People have been talking about it for some considerable time. The problem is trying to get those in power to take action on it.
No, thank you both there for your comments. I think where I'm coming from, certainly the feedback that I'm getting through the submissions, but also when you are speaking to the disabled community and disability charities, is that they can't wait. I think action is required now in order for them to feel valued, to feel as though that they are part of, you know, something wider that does protect them and encompass their rights. So I think that's where the sort of buffer is just now. And of course, there has been explanations in terms of what could be done in order to enhance their rights. I'm just wondering as well if I could ask about an implementation of a learning disability, autism and neurodiversity commissioner. Is that something that the panel supports? And I'm happy to throw out whoever wants to. Stephanie, thank you.
Stephanie, do you want to? Yes. I think that the potential issues that we're speaking about now in connection with this bill are potentially the same issues that we would raise in terms of the establishment of a learning disabilities, autism and neurodiversity commissioner as well. Neurodivergence Commissioner, sorry. It's for the Scottish Parliament ultimately to decide how they allocate their resources and decide what bodies it wants to set up. But what I would say is that some of the issues that we're raising just now in terms of duplication, and we might come on to some of the specifics around that, exist in relation to establishing a learning disability, autism and neurodiversity commissioner too. Those complications around remit and duplication, I think, become even more tangled and difficult to navigate if there are another two commissioners on top of the sort of commissions that are represented here today, civil society and the sort of powers and actions that are currently being taken. I'm not sure if that's helpful, but that's my sort of... I haven't examined the bill in any detail, but, generally, I think that would be our position.
No, that is helpful, because my concerns certainly come from the fact that you'd have some sections of the disabled community that would have a commissioner and others that would not. So that is helpful. I'm not sure if that's the feelings. Yes, Dr. Chopra.
Totally agree with what Stephanie said. I think there'd be a real risk of duplication. So if you're someone with a learning disability who also has a mental illness, or even if you're someone who has a learning disability alone, where would you go to if you felt your rights were not being upheld? I mean, you'd first contact the service. You could potentially go down the SPSO route. Mm-hmm. You could come to the Mental Welfare Commission. You could speak to us. You could end up also speaking to any of the other commissioners, and you might be speaking to an LDAN commissioner. There would be that potential for duplication, actually making things more difficult for people. I think Jan talked about the landscape being already quite complex, and I think it would add a degree of complexity without necessarily making things any easier for people in terms of seeking kind of, what rights should they be expecting and how are those rights going to be safeguarded. So I think there are real risks with that. There are, of course, lots of things that could be achieved through a learning disability, autism and neurodivergence bill. So the Commission is only one part of that bill, but there are so many tangible safeguards. And I think what needs to be what could make them real is that the accountability for delivering those safeguards is very clearly allocated with the existing commissioners and with service providers, rather than considering an additional commissioner as a way forward.
Well, that's helpful. Thank you very much, Convener. Thank you, Pam.
Thanks, Megan. Paul, is there anything you wanted to pick up in the space before I bring in Evelyn?
I don't think so, actually, Convener. I think that's well covered.
Okay. Thanks, Paul. Evelyn, over to you.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel, and thanks for your answers so far. From what you've said, you all agree with the premise of the bill and why it's required. I think I'm picking up that you're all anxious that it's potentially under-resourced. And Stephanie, you mentioned that the funding that's to be used for the bill could possibly be used in a better way to fund existing organisations. And what I want to get from the panel is, I mean, the Scottish Government are saying in the first year that they probably have to set aside at least £1 million, which, as I said, you've said is an under-resourcing issue. But how could your organisations use that funding to achieve the aims of the bill? And maybe I'll ask Stephanie first.
Thank you for that question. Well, we are not funded by the Scottish Parliament, so that's probably the main thing for me to flag here. But I do think, just as a commission with sort of limited defined resources, you know, there's always more that we could do. The Commission, the Equality and Human Rights Commission, over the years, you know, has focused on issues relating to disabled people, whether it's our DWP investigation, whether it's our disabled people in housing inquiry. So we feel that, you know, within the sort of resources that we have, and obviously we are sort of focused on all 9 protected characteristics, that we have been able to do some good work in terms of further inequality for disabled people. But you know, it's a generalisation, a cliche, if you like, but you know, the more resource you have, the more you can do.
Okay. Would anyone else like to come in?
Yeah, thank you. I think it's useful maybe just for me to say a little bit about why we're concerned about the resourcing level that's been allocated provisionally to this office. The proposed Disability Commissioner's office. So the financial memorandum anticipates 3 policy staff and 1 admin staff, with the potential to go down to 0.5 admin staff if there's a shared services model in place. So the first thing that jumps out to me in terms of when I'm looking at the comparison between that and our office is that there's no participation staff. So participation is a huge part of what we do, as I think a number of members of this committee will be really well aware, and that's absolutely integral to ensuring that children and young people feel that the office is working for them and with them. There's a really significant resourcing need around that, to have someone in the office who's able to provide that level of expertise to the rest of the staff group, so that you can really ensure that participation is at the heart of everything you do, and that is absolutely acutely the necessity for a disability commissioner as well. You can't rely on a website and leaflets to communicate with disabled children and young people. Rights holders will have a legitimate expectation that they're going to be meaningfully included in the commissioner's work, and I just don't think that's mm-hmm. that's provided for. There's no legal or investigation staff provided for, and our experience is that an investigation, I think, needs to be understood as a legal process. It's not just a piece of research with some additional powers attached to it. You are at risk potentially of being challenged around mm-hmm. acting beyond your legal powers if you're not careful to construct these things properly. And so there's a question for me about the extent to which the Commission is going to be able to exercise those powers. They can also be quite complex and resource intensive, particularly in terms of staff time to actually undertake. I think there's also something for me around, and again, I suppose this goes to the point about there are elements of our offices that are very, very visible to people, and that there's an awful lot that just kind of happens under the radar, under the water, behind the scenes. And one of those is about the the statutory obligations that exist on you as a public body. So there's a whole range of compliance duties that I think most people looking at our offices would just be entirely unaware of. And not all of that can be done by shared services. If I can give you a couple of really quick examples. There's an anticipation by the member that the office would need to be included within the Public Services Reform Act, but there's a couple of schedules, I think, where they would need to be listed that are the missed out, and those schedules come along with responsibilities. I would expect that they would have to be listed as a corporate parent in terms of the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014. That comes along with a requirement to prepare a plan. They'd be captured by all manner of pieces of legislation that relate to public bodies, some of those Scottish Parliament legislation, some of it's Westminster. And we've just had an experience of having gone through an unexpected process where the public sector bodies, websites and mobile applications, number 2, accessibility regulations, which I'm sure everyone will be intimately familiar with, but which allows the UK government to scrutinise your websites and to require you in very short order to make significant changes to it. Now, that came along with a cost that we hadn't anticipated. That came along with a significant investment of staff time that we hadn't anticipated. There are a number of pieces of legislation that will impose those kinds of duties on the commissioner that I just don't think have been thought through. And then there are audit requirements that apply to all of us as public bodies in order to make sure that we're appropriately using public funds, and those can be hugely time and resource intensive for our corporate services team. I know they block off, you know, 3 or 4 months to get through audit, and there's a significant cost attached to that as well. So that I think is really important in understanding where we're coming from when we talk about lack of resources, and because when you set up a new body, what you're dealing with is not just the setup costs, but also the fixed costs that exist around staffing, around pension contributions, around IT, before you even get to the point where the money that you're investing is delivering work on the ground. And so if the question is, you know, what more could we do with that, with additional resource? One of the most frustrating things about working for a body like ours, like the others represented here, is that you're always butting up against the limits of your resource. You're always having to make really difficult and challenging decisions about what you prioritise, what you work on, what you don't work on. And while we do always give very careful consideration to the extent to which issues disproportionately or differentially impact on particular groups of children and young people who are accorded special protection under the UNCRC, there are always issues where we don't have the resource that we need to go and do work. That, I think, may become more acute post-July, when the opportunities for the office to engage in litigation start to come through. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't be at all surprised if we're having to say no to a lot of potential cases simply because we don't have the staff capacity and the budget to take them all forward. We're going to have to make some really careful and deliberate decisions about the cases that we get involved in.
Okay. Yeah, I suppose what I'm trying to get at is, you know, you're all doing, you know, part of a bigger picture, part of the job, and you've all agreed with the premise of the bill and what it's trying to achieve. But could that, I know it's only £1 million in the first instance, but could those resources be used more effectively to meet those aims with, you know, the existing organisations that are available? Would anyone else like to come in?
I see both Jan and Aaron. Jan, I'll come to you first, and then Aaron.
Perfect. Thank you very much. So yes, I mean, I think I completely endorse everything that Nick's just outlined in respect of what it really costs to set up, run and manage a public body and ensure efficient and effective use of public funds. It costs money to do that, for all the reasons that Nick has outlined. And in the context then of setting up new public bodies to look after and upholding the rights of people, then ultimately the more public bodies we set up to do that, the more public funds is diverted to the running of and the administration costs of public bodies rather than the work to uphold people's human rights through policy and legal work and participation work critically. Could we do more with it? So I guess I would refer the committee to the conversations we've been having with the Public Finance and Administration Committee in respect aspect of the review of the current commissioner landscape and a more strategic approach to that. I won't put a figure on this today, but I will commit to sharing this with the committee thereafter. We are going to put in a further written submission to the Public Finance Administration Committee, outlining exactly where we see the current deficiencies in the Commission's mandate after 16 years, what powers and general duties we would like the committee to consider for the Commission, and what we believe that would cost us to implement. We wouldn't have set up costs, but we'd be looking obviously at extending the general staff team and our ability to take forward more cases. Specifically, that we'll be looking at removing the restriction on the Commission providing advice to individuals, which is something we can't do at the moment, and that includes disabled people. It would be looking at the cost of raising legal proceedings, as Nick has just outlined. You wouldn't be doing that every 5 minutes, but when you do it, it can be quite an expensive thing to do, and that needs to be considered. And actually, the participation of people in the work of the Commission. We do not have a general duty to include people in the work of the Commission in the same way that the Children's Commissioner does under Section 6, I think it is, of Nick's Act. That is a duty, that's the deficiency that we believe is in our mandate, and we would like to see it achieved differently. Our core budget this year is £1.4 million, just to be clear for the committee, and that's to uphold all of those human rights for all of those people all across Scotland. So, I think that will be of interest to the committee to share with you that ballpark figure that we then give to the Public Finance and Administration Committee. And then in respect of the other elements, so the notion of a rapporteurship model or a dedicated team with a champion within the Commission that's focused solely on the rights of disabled people in Scotland, I think it's fair to say that to set up a team of the same size and scale as has been proposed in the Disability Commissioner Bill, so a team of three plus administration, to set that up within the context of the Scottish Human Rights Commission would cost a lot less, of course it would, because you wouldn't have the set-up costs of a brand new public body to contend with. So I hope that's helpful, and I'll certainly commit to bringing those figures back to the committee in writing.
Thanks, Jan. And Aaron?
Thank you. It's a fantastic question. What would we do with £1 million? Totally agree with what my colleagues have said. And I'd want to kind of consider this within my team and with disability groups. But one of the areas that I think is a gap is around investigations. And I don't think we're doing sufficient work on investigating when things do not work out for people with disabilities, particularly people with learning disabilities. When you look across the UK in other jurisdictions, there is a programme that investigates any death of a person with learning disability, and we don't have that in Scotland up and running. In fact, we're actually, I think, far behind in many areas. The death of everyone in detention is not investigated in Scotland. Healthcare Improvement Scotland don't investigate all incidents either, and people can wait ages for an FAI through the coronial system. So I think we have a real gap around the investigation work. I know that's one of the powers which is mentioned in this Disability Commissioner Bill. It's also one of the things which is on the Patient Safety Commissioner Bill. So I think we're all recognising that this is a gap in the Scottish landscape. Mm-hmm. But yeah, if there's £1 million going, that's what I think would be a priority, I think, would be to sort out that investigation landscape with the aim of improving things and making clear recommendations to prevent anything like that happening to any other family or any other person. Thanks.
Thanks, Aaron. Anything else from you, Evelyn?
That's me, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll move to Paul then.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I think it's been a very interesting discussion so far, and I think we've touched on the importance of intersectionality when it comes to human rights. And I just wondered if the panel might want to expand on, I suppose, the importance of that intersectionality and why I think it's crucial that we reflect on this bill with that very much at the forefront of our minds. So I don't know if there's anything people would like to add just to that need for an intersectional approach. And Jan, I'll maybe start with you.
Happy to. Great question. I think, as I said in my opening statement, so human rights are universal, they're interdependent, and they're indivisible. So that's the fundamental framework which protects all of our human rights. And one of the issues that's been raised by this bill is the potential to create the hierarchy of rights. And the question that raises, I think, for all of us as individuals, do we define an individual and their rights by a characteristic? And if a disabled person will also be a woman, perhaps, an older woman, perhaps, or a woman who identifies as LGBT, or where does that person go in respect of access to remedy for their human rights? The Human Rights Commission has been set up in this country, as it is in countries across the world, all accredited by the United Nations, as national human rights institutions that protect all of those human rights and offer the same routes to remedy for every citizen equally. And that's a really, really important principle in terms of the access to justice system around the human rights of everyone. So I think the bill as proposed certainly creates a different route for disabled people to go through. And actually what it does start to do is further then create different levels of scrutiny and different levels of accountability for different groups of rights. And I think the precedent that sets is probably more concerning than the justification for doing so. So it definitely is a concern from the perspective of access to justice in the Scottish human rights legal framework.
Stephanie? Sorry, Steph, do
you
want to come in?
Yeah, thank you for that. I agree with what Jan is saying, and I think just reflecting on our work at the Equality and Human Rights Commission, one of the benefits of being the regulator of the Equality Act and its 9 protected characteristics is that we can take an intersectional approach to our work. I'm particularly thinking about sort of keeping law and policies under review and how we do that in respect of all 9 protected characteristics, such as considering any evidence that we have of intersectional issues. I think in that context, we consider an intersectional approach of utmost importance when upholding rights. And we know that sort of law or policy might impact differently on disabled women and men. Services might meet the needs of white disabled people, but not the needs of disabled people from certain ethnic minorities. In our State of the Nation report, which I referred to earlier, as Scotland Fairer outlined that disabled people face particular issues in relation to socioeconomic inequality. One of our findings was that disabled people are more likely to experience worse living standards than non-disabled people, and the proportion of disabled adults in poverty increased between 2012, 2013 and 2019, 2020. So in that context, I think an intersectional approach is really important, and any commissioner focused solely on disability would have to be sort of cognizant of such intersections and build that into their work.
I totally agree with what Stephanie's just said, and it's reminded me of something that I said to the deputy convener at the outset when we were talking about, I gave an example of a safeguard of when someone's detained under an emergency detention certificate, that they get a social worker, an MHO, a mental health officer, as a safeguard. So it's not just one professional, it's not just a medic making that decision. And just thinking, and mental illness counts as a disability if it's within the framework of both the Equalities Act and with the definitions from CRPD, particularly for those mental illnesses which last for a long time. Just thinking of that individual safeguard that I mentioned, though, and the intersectionality that comes with ethnicity. Because we monitor the Mental Health Act and we monitor the way that it's been working for the last 15 years, what we've shown that for that safeguard that I mentioned to the deputy convener, if you're white Scottish, you are much more likely to have a social worker check that your detention or kind of be part of that detention process. But if you're black in Scotland, or if you're coming from another minoritised ethnic community, you're much less likely to get that same safeguard. So there's a huge intersectionality. We published this, I think it was a few years ago, in a report on the Commission's website, Race Inequality in Mental Health Services in Scotland. So we've shown that intersectional nature of what happens when you have a disability and you're coming from a particular minoritised group, you're much less likely to get it. The way forward is to make those safeguards, and this touches on what Jan was saying about making sure that it's there for everyone. If you make the safeguard mandatory, then you disproportionately improve things for people who are coming from minoritised groups.
Any other questions?
I just wondered if I could just touch on the Equality Act point, because I think that is interesting, and I think it will be something of relevance in terms of the bill and its interaction, if you like, with the Equality Act. So you know, I think, Stephanie, from your point of view, it would be interesting to get your view on the interactions with the Equality Act. But I think in specifically, I noticed that you had raised some concerns, or the Commission had raised some concerns about the overlap, if you like. So we talk about inclusive communication in this bill, but how does that actually interact with the need for reasonable adjustments as set out in the Equality Act? And is it blurring the lines now in terms of what each piece of law should do? So it would be good, I think, for committees just to have your view on that.
Yes, thanks for that question. I think there are a number of aspects of the bill that, you know, if the bill is agreed and a disability commissioner is introduced, established, there might be overlap in terms of our remit. You mentioned inclusive communication, and I think, you know, this is something that has been another pieces of legislation, and I think what has been missing is a definition of what inclusive communication actually is. You know, the Social Security Act included a provision for inclusive communication, and Social Security Scotland did a lot of work sort of off their own back to sort of work out what that might mean in the context of benefits, and it's been really great work, and, you know, we have had interaction with Social Security Scotland about how they've done that. But in terms of the legislation that we're looking at, I think, you know, the bill sets out, and I'm just having a quick look at the wording, that the Commissioner must have regard to the importance of communicating in a way that ensures disabled people who have difficulty communicating or accessing information in relation to speech, language or otherwise can express themselves and access and receive information. I am not clear on what inclusive communication actually means in that context. It's any different from what the reasonable adjustments duty is. You know, Section 20 of the Equality Act and the reasonable adjustments duty is quite clear that there's a duty on service providers currently to make reasonable adjustments to remove or reduce barriers faced by disabled people. That's an anticipatory duty. And yes, I think in that specific regard, I'm not 100% clear on what the legislative gap is there, what it's trying to achieve that isn't already achieved by the reasonable adjustments duty. In terms of sort of wider issues, in terms of duplication or overlap of remit, every function set out under Section 2 of the bill has the potential to overlap with existing functions of EHRC. And I'll not take up too much time going through sort of every function and the corresponding aspects of the 2006 Equality Act that sort of established the Equality and Human Rights Commission and give us our powers. But what I will say is that there is quite a lot of overlap. Almost every provision sort of corresponds directly to a provision of the 2006 Act. And I think that the sort of main thing that we have focused on in our consultation response is the potential for significant overlap in terms of the powers of investigation that have been proposed. So as I've kind of previously alluded to, I don't know if I've given enough detail on it, but we have powers of investigation in relation to suspected unlawful acts under the Equality Act 2010, including the discrimination, harassment and victimisation of disabled people. We can compel evidence. It's an offence not to comply, enforceable in court. And a recent example, which I've already given a couple of times, is our DWP investigation to establish whether successive secretaries of state for work and pension have committed unlawful acts under the Equality Act. The investigatory power in the bill appears to both overlap with our powers and also be significantly weaker, in that the legal enforcement powers that we are afforded by the Equality Act 2006, which include applying for interdicts and instigating judicial review, are missing from this bill. Section 6 of the bill, I think, does try to sort of attempt to address some of these issues by providing that an investigation can't take place if it's the function of another person. And there are provisions around sort of consulting with the bodies whose role it might be. But I think there still remains a risk that proposed power, not least in relation to individual investigations, strays into conduct prohibited by the Equality Act 2010, particularly discrimination, and therefore out with devolved competence. I know that's a very sort of EHRC-focused answer, and, you know, that doesn't sort of touch on the fact that there are numbers of organisations, sort of statutory and otherwise, that are operating in this space as well. But that particular sort of overlap with the Equality Act is of particular concern to us.
Thanks, Paul. I know Nick wanted to come in on that too.
Yeah, I wondered if I could just come in on the duplication point, unless there's a question coming up.
Yeah.
On that.
No. Go for it.
Thank you. It's just to really reflect some of what Stephanie has just said, and with a particular focus on the Children's Commissioner's Office. So we are concerned that we don't inadvertently restrict the ability of existing office holders to undertake work And so the investigation power within this bill is very obviously kind of mirrored on our investigation power. It's almost a direct kind of cut and paste. We have a provision which is reflected in this bill about non-duplication, where work is properly the function of another body, and that can be complex to navigate. It will become increasingly complex here because there's an addition to that provision within the Disability Commissioner mm-hmm. bill that doesn't exist within ours, which is that even where the Disability Commissioner considers that an investigation would duplicate the work of another body, they can still proceed to carry it out. And so that, even though, so they're required to consult, but they can still proceed to carry out an investigation. And we're concerned that, that in practice that would result in us potentially being cut out of work that would in our view properly be the role and responsibility of the Children's Commissioner's Office.
Okay. Thanks, Nick. Anything else from you, Paul? No, you're happy. We had Marie McNair online as well to ask a couple of questions, but have we been able to... She dropped off. Have we been able to get her back? Okay, if we can get her on in the next couple of minutes, we will. But in the meantime, in the conversations we've had so far, that there've been a couple of questions, particularly around participation and engagement with different groups of disabled people, different members of the diverse and varied disability community across Scotland. Where are the challenges, do you think, in having a bill or having a commissioner like this in I suppose it's a follow-on from what Megan Gallagher was talking about, how we understand disability in the round, and how would you see, rather than a disability commissioner, how would you see us tackle some of the potential tensions, maybe even conflicts, within that whole disabled people context within Scotland? I don't know. Jan, do you want to maybe...
I'll give it a go. I think... you're talking here about a community that's not homogenous. It's very diverse, as are every community in every walk of life. I think that would be a challenge for a disability commissioner as well, as one champion with a very small team. Mm-hmm. And as Nick has outlined, actually with insufficient projected budget, as far as I can see, to actually properly get out and encourage participation in its work. I think our experience in the Commission just now in respect of our monitoring work around how disabled people's rights have been enjoyed is partnership work with civil society organisations. It's the best that this Commission can do currently because we actually are prevented from engaging with individuals or providing advice. But I think that also then points to the potential duplicative nature of what then a disability commissioner would then add to the current landscape. But I think it's critical that it's costed well, because it takes money and it takes time. So to be out and about, to engage with people, to deeply listen, to do that well, to make that fully accessible, to ensure then that checks are in place to ensure that people's views are appropriately being represented and heard, and then to close that circle and feed back to people about what the impact has been of that engagement, that takes a lot of energy and time and expertise that is quite different and distinct from policy expertise or legal expertise, and that will be one of the challenges that would be faced by the current proposed disability commissioner model, but would indeed be a challenge for any of our organisations to engage appropriately and perhaps better. But I think definitely commitment to engagement with existing strong civil society organisations is the route through that.
Okay, thanks, Jan. Anybody else want to pick up on that point? Aaron.
I totally agree with what Jan just said there about that being a particular challenge, and about, you know, the group being quite diverse, and ensuring their voices is not easy, and it does require time and effort to engage. Through legislation, one of the committees that the board of the Mental Welfare Commission has to have is an advisory committee, which is made up of people who come from diverse groups who would have cause to influence the way that our board makes decisions about what we choose to do. So that is one model that could be could be put forward if that was the route we were going down around a disability commissioner. Before working in Scotland, I worked out in New Zealand, and the equivalent to my organisation, actually, its board is set up with people with lived experience, so they determine mm-hmm. how... So that's another model that's in existence. And I think it is crucial to have that lived experience, which is determining what route an organisation takes. But there are models that are available from different places.
Thanks. And of course, Nick outlined in the Children and Young People's Commissioners, the lived experience, the participation of young people is vital to that. Is there anything else you'd like to add on that, Nick?
Only that... One of the really strong and consistent messages that's come from our engagement with children and young people, certainly in the 7 or so years that I've been within the office, and I'm sure kind of before that, is that what they want from us is engagement face to face. So I think there's sometimes an assumption for children and young people that because they're very digitally literate, that what they're looking for predominantly is that kind of online engagement. Mm-hmm. But actually, what comes across really, really strongly is they want us to go to the places where they feel comfortable. They want to be able to develop those relationships. They want to be able to build trust by kind of sitting down and spending a bit of time with you. And so the level of resource and of time and of commitment that's required to do that properly is really, really significant. I mean, it also affects, you know, very, very prosaically things like travel budgets, for instance, because you need to be able to go to places that are out with the Central Belt. You need to be able to go up to the Highlands and Islands. You need to be able to go and see those kind of communities where children and young people are and where they want you to come and engage in their spaces.
Okay, thanks. Stephanie, is there anything else you'd like to add?
I don't think I've got much to add. I agree fully with what each of the panel members have already said. I think the only other thing that sort of occurred to me as others were speaking was the potential for sort of consultation fatigue. You know, a lot of DPOs, disabled people's organisations, whether they're sort of national, regional, local, whether they're sort of focusing on disability generally or whether it's about specific conditions or impairments, they do an awful lot of heavy lifting in terms mm-hmm. of responding to consultations, both of, you know, Scottish Parliament, engaging with bodies like ours. And I think if a disability commissioner is to be established, there's a real need for HRC, but also the commissioner themselves to really focus on working with other bodies and sort of sharing information and taking some of that burden or repetition and replication that's put on DPOs off them.
I mean, that point you made there about sharing information is an interesting. We haven't really touched on the barriers to sharing information across existing organisations, never mind additional ones. So that's something. For us to consider as well. I suppose, finally, given what you've said about participation, as this committee progresses through our gathering of evidence at the stage for this bill and proposal, are there people, are there groups, are there organisations that you think we absolutely must talk to, that we maybe need to make sure are on our list over the coming weeks? Any suggestions or ideas? Nick?
To say the thing you would expect me to say, which is children and young people, but I recognise that the parliaments or the committees having to deal with a process that has timescales attached to it, and so obviously it's a matter for you to determine what's realistic and what's doable over the time period that you have available.
Okay. Jan?
Just to add, you'll have, I'm sure, DPOs, I think, are really important as a route to ensuring direct voices of disabled people informing the inquiry. I would also recommend conversations with perhaps the clerks and or convener of the Public Finance and Administration Committee in respect of the parallel inquiry process there. And as I alluded to earlier in my contributions, I think some insight from the Scottish Government Bill team, perhaps, on the Human Rights Bill, or indeed the Cabinet Secretary or Minister there would be essential, because I think an understanding and appreciation of how the Scottish legal framework around CRPD in Scotland in particular is actually really critical to informing how the accountability mechanisms need to shape around disabled people's rights in Scotland. So I think some early insight for the committee on that point would be really, really useful.
Thanks, Jen. And your point about the work that the Finance and Public Administration Committee is doing is well made, and and I think we'll look with interest to that additional material you send them. If you could share it with us as well, that would be great. Aaron,
Deputy Convener, I think it would also be helpful to hear from, if possible, from the LDAN team, the Learning Disability Autism and Neurodivergence Bill team. It would also be helpful to speak to the Directorate around progress around the Scottish Mental Health Law Review. Mm-hmm. There is a section around accountability and governance within that where there are proposals and recommendations. It'd be helpful to hear where things are at with that process, because that will impact on this. And it may be helpful to have some evidence from Healthcare Improvement Scotland, who create guidance and guideline notes for care and treatment of people, many of them who have disabilities, and it might be helpful just to see what their thinking is in this space.
Okay. Thank you. Any final... We've not been able to get Marie back online. Any final points or comments that you want to make sure that we hear before you go away? Just give you the... Jan, do you want to...?
Just one, if I may. I think we've all expressed across the panel this morning how significant some of the concerns our organisations have around rights violations for disabled people in Scotland today, and in particular the human rights of people with learning disabilities and autism has been raised on a number of occasions. That's a core priority focus for the Commission this year, and we will be publishing an output later this year highlighting the human rights framework around long-term detentions of people with learning disabilities and autism in forensic mental health settings. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, without having concluded that piece of work fully, it's likely that we will find evidence of quite significant human rights violations. And I suppose my final reflections at the end of this evidence session are, what would the Disability Commissioner proposal add to that beyond what we can do currently, which is bear witness to it, verify it, share it with Parliament, publicise it, highlight it with Scottish Government, and that's it. Yeah. And I guess that's the bigger question I would just want to sort of leave with the committee is that's all any of us care about, is ensuring that there is an improvement in the system that creates some form of accountability lever that takes us beyond that. Mm-hmm. And whether that's through a disability commissioner or whether that's through enhancing the powers and general duties of existing bodies, that fundamentally is the only question that matters.
Okay. Thank you very much all. And I'm aware that we've also got three different types of commissions in front of us this morning. So it's been really interesting to hear your different perspectives, your different reporting mechanisms as well, and your own different accountability structures too. So something for us to take on board and to consider too as we progress with this work. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you for the evidence you've given us. And I'm sure you'll be hearing from us in due course as we progress this work. I'll now suspend the meeting briefly as we will move into... No, actually, we're just moving into private session now. So thank you all very much.